Good evening, everyone, and welcome. My name is Sarah Thrall, and I'm the Director of Artistic Operations at the Lexington Philharmonic. I'm so happy that everyone could join us virtually this evening for the final installment of this season's Connect virtual series. I'm excited for everyone to learn from and get to know our amazing guests this evening. But before I turn it over to Kelly for introductions, just a couple housekeeping notes for Zoom. Even though we can't see everyone who is joining us, we still want to hear and engage with you. So for folks on Zoom, please put any questions, comments, or feedback in the chat or Q&A feature, and our guests will be able to see and respond to them. For those of you joining us on Facebook, you can engage or ask questions of our guests in the comments on Facebook. Our Connect talk this evening is hosted by LexPhil's Interim Artistic Advisor, Kelly Corcoran. So without further ado, I will turn it over to Kelly.
Thanks, Sarah. It's great to be here with everybody. Good evening. And as LexPhil continues the final chapter of our season focused on musical storytelling, we wanted to take a moment to engage in conversation with Dr. Terry Dean and Dr. Ben Arnold about Prokofiev and the art music of World War II in advance of LexPhil's performance later this month of Prokofiev's Symphony No. 5. So composed in Soviet Russia in the summer of 1944, Prokofiev describes his Fifth Symphony as praising the free and happy man. And our conversation tonight will explore Prokofiev's life, this important symphonic work, and the cultural environment in which it was composed. As Sarah mentioned, we welcome questions from our audience along the way as well. So we have two wonderful guests with us today. Dr. Terry Dean is Associate Professor of Musicology and Gender Studies at Indiana State University, and he is a specialist in Russian and Soviet music. So thank you for being with us today, Terry. It's good to have you. And Dr. Ben Arnold is professor and coordinator for musicology and ethnomusicology at the University of Kentucky here in Lexington, and his research interests focus on music written in the context of war. So thank you for joining us today, Ben. We're glad to have you with us too. All right, so I encourage everybody here to read more about each of our guests at the respective websites that we've shared in the chat. And I do also want to note that Prokofiev was born in Ukraine. And while this conversation will not focus on the current crisis and unfolding tragedy and violence occurring in Ukraine, we will be sharing some general resources for those interested in learning more about Ukrainian music and culture a bit later in our talk. So before we dive into Prokofiev and his life and his music, I have a giant question for both of you to kick off our conversation. And it is about how, in general, how did the context and events of World War II impact classical composers at the time? So I know this is a huge question, and I think it would be great to touch on the ways in which composers were displaced, but also, you know, how the music was literally impacted and more. So just a few things in my mind here as I ask this question. I'm thinking a little bit here about Stravinsky and Liszt Warta Soldat in the midst of World War I, and how many composers wrote smaller pieces simply because of the forces available to them. And then I also think a little bit about the pandemic. While it's not the same thing exactly, it's had a huge impact on the types of pieces that composers are writing. And so we know that world events, of course, are impacting music. So how did World War II impact classical composers? And I don't know which one of you wants to start. It's a huge question.
I can give a little background. Yeah, it's interesting that each country had their own way of doing things. In Germany, with their history, they went back to Wagner and Beethoven and Bruckner, and they almost had no important new music being written during this time. The Soviet Union, as a new country or a new empire in ways, they were trying to promote Soviet realism. So they were pushing or encouraging and actually were quite organized. So the forces of the composition people in the Soviet Union were turning out music by the boatloads, literally thousands of songs, popular songs. And these were the classical composers too, Shostakovich, Prokofiev, Mussorgsky. They were all contributing to the war effort. So they produced by far the most music of anyone during World War II that was contemporary. And there were restrictions that we'll talk about later, but they were to promote the army. In America, the composers wanted to, but there wasn't any real organized force. At the same time, because of America, once they entered the war, there was more American music of contemporary composers being performed than ever before. So it really was a boost to the music making in America. The film industry was very important as well. So that gives you some context of three different countries of how they approached it.
And to sort of follow up on that, the United States benefited a lot from the events of what's happening in Europe. We have an influx of some of the greatest composers, conductors, performers. We have Hindemith, we have Bartok. We have so many of these great contributors to music during this first half of the 20th century arriving on our shores, teaching in our universities, relocating here, trying to promote the same kind of symphony orchestra quality and status that they had experienced when they were working in Europe at the time.
So, and then what about in the types of pieces that were being written, you know, during the war? I mean, did they tend to be, you know what I mean? I think that sometimes there's an assumption that things are going to be patriotic or, you know, maybe somber. And I know we probably see all of those things in the range of music being written, but are there any kind of themes that emerge in the music that we see from this period in terms of the content or context?
So for the Soviet Union, as Ben said, there's a sort of outpouring of great works. There's this promotion of the large genres. Opera sort of got brought back to life in the hands of Soviet composers. We see the symphony. Richard Truskin calls these sort of the mastodons of the past. These are the genres that they're composing in. But there's also mass songs, unison songs that the entire people can enjoy and participate in with music making. We have great patriotic cantatas. We have film music that's coming out. All of these having, if not sort of exploring themes that were contemporary, World War II, even World War I most recently, they're looking at sort of the cult of the leader, elevating Stalin to this status as this sort of mythical great leader. Alexander Nevsky was predates the World War II, but we have Ivan the Terrible. We have a number of works that sort of lift these people up and put them on par with the leaders that were sort of taking charge of the Soviet people at the time. And so that's one of the things that we start to see there. In the United States, lots of other great examples of patriotism. Lincoln Portrait's one that comes to mind from Copeland.
Yeah, the Soviets that we know the most, Prokofiev and Shostakovich, were contributing major symphonic music during this time. It's not just the Fifth that we're going to talk about today, but 1941, obviously, the Leningrad Symphony, the Symphony No. 7 of Shostakovich, became so famous all over the world. And since we were the part of the Allies with the Soviet Union, we too performed it almost immediately here. Koussevitzky, the Russian conductor, performed it here. So Shostakovich's works, that symphony was very much propaganda for the Soviet Union with its opening march, and was seen as something very patriotic to the Russian people. His Eighth Symphony, though, that he wrote in 1943, was seen as too depressing, too dark, and it later was banned. Because it didn't fit the profile that he wanted. So there was an enormous amount of music. Prokofiev writing the film scores to Ivan the Terrible. These types of things were going on very much so in the Soviet Union. Promoting the war, War and Peace, that he'd been thinking about for some time, it gave him the impetus to write the opera and work on that pretty much throughout much of the war. So it was very strong war efforts in opera and symphony. Just one other quick follow-up. Yeah. Because of the success of Shostakovich's Seventh Symphony, the Americans started writing and reviving the symphony more. So you have people like Samuel Barber, you have Bernstein, you have Antal, you have just the symphony becoming much more important. Roy Harris and even Copeland with his Sixth Symphony or his Third Symphony at the end in 1946. The symphony was trying to compete with the Russian Soviet symphony, but it was not quite as popular really as what the Soviets were able to do. As I'd mentioned, I'm looking at this stuff, the Soviet composers, Shostakovich and Prokofiev, were both put on American magazines. No American composer reached that kind of popularity in their own country. It was our allies that we were supporting.
Yeah. Okay, so I know we're going to talk much more deeply about all of this, and so I thought it might be fun to start our conversation pretty quickly by hearing some Prokofiev and hearing a little bit of the symphony. So we're going to hear a little bit of the second movement of Prokofiev's Symphony No. 5. This is the Allegro Marcato. It's performed by the Berlin Philharmonic and conducted by Gustavo Dudamel, and this movement is a fast scherzo full of Prokofiev's sardonic sense of humor. Yeah, I see the chat. Love the humor in this movement. Yeah, let's listen. Love that movement, and I think it's a great performance. So I just would love to hear from both of you your thoughts on why you think that is so characteristically Prokofiev.
I'll take this one. So for me, Prokofiev's music tends to be sort of this combination of tradition and innovation. There's this quest for individuality. So we hear that throughout the symphony, but there's a playfulness to this movement or the excerpt that I think is pretty typical of Prokofiev. He had a wicked sense of humor. He was very, very confident. There's some optimism. There's a lot of satire in his personality. And then as far as just some of the more Prokofievan characteristics, he was a pianist. He had these steely fingers. So there's this constant undercurrent, machine-like pulsation, toccata-like writing. So that's one of the first things that comes out to me, that the music doesn't tend to be developmental. So there's lots of little sections that get added together, built on one another, as opposed to this singular idea that gets churned out and developed organically over time. And then there's this lyricism that he really concentrated on during his time in the Soviet Union, partly for accessibility, but partly due to his own sort of aesthetic crisis of the late 20s, the early 30s, when he was starting to recognize that not all audiences could connect with his music. So he sort of simplified, he called it his new simplicities. And so we see this emphasis on lyricism that gets sort of toyed around with in a number of different ways. This isn't necessarily singable all the time, but it's very clear melody, clear sort of unfolding of a melodic line that's quite lyrical at times.
Great. For me, the melodies, the orchestration that he does, the changes, every when he does vary the theme, which is quite often, he's not developing it so much, it's just a note or two changing. But with that, the instruments almost always change, and the colors that he gets with that energy from the ostinatos, repeated patterns, I think that's what just it brings a smile to your face when you hear this wonderful melodic idea, and he's, as you say, playing around with it, but in such brilliant ways. And to me, the orchestration, because I know he wrote the piano score in 1 month, he did it quickly, but the piano, this would be very boring on. But with the orchestra, he brings it alive in so many ways to make it just absolutely vibrant. And you just want to get up and almost dance to it.
I think that's very much a Rimsky influence, who was his teacher at the conservatory, is this emphasis on color and sound, and he plays around with it in such really interesting ways.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Okay, so in a moment, we're going to turn specifically to Stalin and the Soviet Union, but first, I think we should frame a little bit more about Prokofiev and his life. So, Terry, give us some background on Prokofiev, where he was born, his musical training, maybe a bit of an overview of his musical output. And I think also we can note here the time he spent in New York, and then because he left with the Russian Revolution and then also spent some time in Paris and then came back to the Soviet Union in the 30s. So just kind of a brief Prokofiev life overview.
Brief is the hard part, but I'll do my best.
Yeah.
Prokofiev, born in 1891, died in 1953. He was raised as a child on a sort of a rural Ukrainian estate, village, farming estate. His father was an agronomist, so he was sort of the wealthy little boy who got to play with the other kids who were in the local area. His mother was well trained in the arts, and so she started teaching him piano at the age of four. They took him to his first operas right around 1900, and he decided, he came home, he's like, I'm going to write my own opera. He's 9 years old, and he starts to write his very first opera, The Giant. He, of course, made the children on the estate act in this. I mean, he was the one in charge of all this. And then when they decided that he clearly had a talent for music, they brought Reinhold Glier to the estate. He spent two summers tutoring. He entered the conservatory at his age of 13, 1904, and he basically finished his conservatory training at the age of 18 in 1909, stayed around, got some additional training as a pianist and as a conductor. And it was after he graduated from that in 1914 that his career really takes off. He gets connected with Sergei Diaghilev in the Ballet Russe. He starts some projects with him. They never really see the stage, but we get this great ballet suite called Alla in Loli, or more commonly the Scythian Suite. The revolution sets off in 1917, and I think that because he was in St. Petersburg at the time of the 1905 sort of uprisings, he expected it to be a very short-lived revolution. And so he just sort of left for a while, I think expecting to come back rather relatively quickly, but he travels across Siberia, ends up in Japan for a short while, lands in San Francisco, and then makes his way across to New York, as you said, and he spends his time in the United States until 1922, and he's writing works like Love for Three Oranges. He's got, I think, his third concerto. He's trying to establish himself as a composer and a pianist, so he's doing a lot of performances. But he's in Rachmaninoff's shadow here. So he ends up in Europe in 1922, spends the next decade and a half there, in many ways living in Stravinsky's shadow, before he repatriates in 1936. And he's probably the most internationally renowned composer in the Soviet Union at that time, or well, internationally known, but he's very much an outsider. He's traveled the world in ways that his contemporaries in the Soviet Union hadn't. He's been on multiple continents. He has connections. He has publishers in different parts of the world. But that left him an outsider. He wasn't trained under the Soviet system. He arrives just after they've established socialist realism as the official Soviet aesthetic, and on the heels of Shostakovich's sort of being condemned in Pravda for the Lady Macbeth of Metzen's district opera, where he's being sort of criticized for being what they called a formalist, too modernist, too anything. They didn't tell us what it was supposed to be, but they told us what it shouldn't have been. So too much bourgeois, too much Western, too much jazz, too much dissonance, not enough melody. And so he arrives on the heels of this, and he struggles. He writes a number of great works in his mind that get rejected. He writes some music that he thinks is sort of trite and trivial that people love. And as far as his output, he stays in the sort of success struggle, success struggle in terms of his output. Throughout the rest of his career, in 1948, he gets condemned himself as part of sort of four great composers. There's Shostakovich, of course, Khachaturian, and Miskovsky. They get pulled into, it's called the Zhdvanshchina. It's Andrei Zhdanov basically does to Prokofiev and these others the same thing that happened to Shostakovich with the opera. And he basically never really recovers. He has the Seventh Symphony, which is sort of a successful work, but not really a successful work. He struggles to get operas produced. He never sees a number of his projects performed. So that's sort of his life in a nutshell. His greatest works, though, I think, aren't symphonies. He was a failed symphony composer in the eyes of a lot of people. He had the First Symphony. Wasn't his first project, but his first opus numbered symphony. And then he had three failures, and he steps away for a decade and a half before he comes back with the fifth. And so as far as his great works, we have operas, we have ballets, we have his piano music. He was a pianist, so he was very successful there. We have a few film scores or suites from film scores and ballets, Romeo and Juliet, Lieutenant Kiesje, Cinderella comes out during this World War II. Yeah, I think that sort of hopefully gives everyone a little bit of overview of who he is.
Yeah, no, that's great. And I know, but Ben, we're going to come to you in a second, but one final follow-up question there, Terry, because I watched some of the videos that I think the Boston Symphony had put out about Prokofiev's life, and I think we might have them to put in the chat if people want to watch that as well. But they were saying that when he died, he really didn't have a lot of money, and that like some of his works that were published by Boosey and some of these other publishers in the US, like he wasn't seeing any of that money coming from those publishers. And I just didn't know if you had anything to add about that, because I thought that was really fascinating.
He did struggle financially, and I don't think he was unique to him. A number of composers, they struggle when their works are being, I don't want to say banned necessarily, but they aren't being performed. They're sort of, some of them do get outright banned, but he's not seeing, he's not getting commissions. He's not getting the Soviet commissions that he was really looking forward to. Part of his return was this desire to write for Russian speaking audiences and to have state sponsored commissions, things that he wouldn't have to go out and work so hard to get himself. But with that comes this control of the state that he wasn't necessarily, I think, ready for, and he didn't see the money towards the end of his career, as you said.
Yeah, that's interesting. I think Sarah's putting in the chat those videos now if anybody wants to watch those too. They focus a little bit more on the Sixth Symphony, but some additive content too. So Ben, now let's focus on Stalin and the Soviet Union. So we know that the political environment under Stalin greatly impacted Prokofiev and many composers. So tell us a little bit about Stalin, his rule, and how this impacted Soviet and Russian artists and classical composers.
Great, thank you. Terry's already alluded to it quite a bit, and the fact that it was very repressive. When he first took over, he was more concentrating on things that were not musical or even arts for that matter, and he solidifying his power. But in the 1930s, particularly with the famous Chaos Instead of Music, or Muddle Instead of Music, when he condemned Shostakovich. That was a repressive moment for not just Shostakovich. It let every artist, Shostakovich was very famous in the Soviet Union at the time, and this was a statement that says, you have to write what I want or you will be in Pravda and we'll be talking about you, and very badly. So Shostakovich supposedly really feared for his life, and I'm sure every composer was nervous from that point on. So you have that because they know the purges. People are disappearing. We know that hundreds of thousands, millions of people perhaps, were arrested and died through these Stalin purges. And even Prokofiev's first wife is going to be taken away to camps later on. I mean, the story of Stalin's power and the fear that he put into and the distress that he gave Prokofiev in his later years was just overwhelming. So yes, composers could not write what they wanted to write, as Terry's already alluded to, because they feared for their life. They feared for repression. They feared that they would do something, because Jerry also said the rules weren't there. So they didn't know exactly what they had to write. So they were trying to write things. And sometimes, I know in one work of Prokofiev, he was going to be quoting Stalin, and it wasn't going to work out, you know, because it's too dangerous to do that. And again, Shostakovich, so much of his reaction to that ban or his condemnation in 1930s, how we may need to thank him in some way, Stalin, for bringing Shostakovich back to more traditional music, because the Fourth Symphony that Shostakovich had written before the ban and was getting ready to premiere was very dissonant. And I think there's no question that Shostakovich's style changed because of the fear for his life. So I think Shostakovich, Prokofiev, both Stalin had an immediate and very strong impact. Also, the Stalin awards that were given out, that showed people what Stalin thought should be awarded and the type of music that they should be writing. So he had an enormous impact. And the irony of this is that Prokofiev and Stalin died on the same day. And they didn't talk about it with Prokofiev because they had to celebrate the great dictator, the great Stalin.
So Ben, how did that Stalin environment shift, like before World War II, during World War II, after World War II? You know, because I guess I thought I read something that maybe during World War II, like there was so much focus on the war. Just how did that kind of shift a little bit?
Yeah, during the war, he was not he was not concentrating on the music specifically. For example, the Shostakovich Eighth Symphony, it would have been condemned earlier, probably. It's one of the darkest works that Shostakovich wrote. I mean, there are bombs going off. It is intense, the way the third movement elides to the fourth movement. I think it's one of the greatest symphonies that Shostakovich wrote, but it's not very popular because of its sadness, its darkness. So yes, there was, for whatever you take with Shostakovich's purported memoirs, the idea that you could write what you wanted to during the war because he wasn't paying attention to it. So there was a little bit of less of that. And the critics themselves were also not sure how to how to review some of these works. After the war, and particularly after Stalin's death in 1953, then it was a complete change. It's when Shostakovich started doing his DSCH motive and the thaw happened. So the music changed dramatically, so that some of these works that were banned early on can be produced again. And even Shostakovich, his banned opera coming back in the 1960s. So it did certainly change after his death. There was always from 1936, there was always that fear that never left the composers and the artists. It wasn't just composers, all artists, and the ballet directors, whomever, could be taken away at any point, and they knew that.
Yeah. Okay, so let's listen to some more music. This is a bit of the beginning of the first movement of the Fifth Symphony, and here we're going to hear a beautiful lyrical theme played by the flute and the bassoon, demonstrating, again, this gift for lyricism and melody that we've talked about a little bit earlier. So here's a little bit of the first movement. I know we could keep listening. It's a beautiful movement, the way it unfolds and continues to go, but you'll have to hear the Lexington Philharmonic if you want to hear the whole thing. And also I just want to chime in here too, to invite anyone watching, if you have any questions, to put it in the chat. We would love to answer any questions along the way. And I know I'm asking some of these questions to you, Terry, or to you, Ben, but obviously if you have things to add along the way to anything anyone said, you know, dive in. So Terry, let's focus now on Prokofiev 5 specifically. And as we said earlier, this was composed in the summer of 1944, and it was premiered January 13th, 1945 at the Moscow Conservatory. So Prokofiev was around 53 when he wrote it, and it had been 14 years since his fourth symphony, excuse me. So tell us a little bit about the genesis of the Fifth Symphony and the political pressure that existed as he was writing it.
So the Fifth Symphony, he started composing the work sometime in July of 1944, finished it in about a month, but he had been sort of, I think, collecting material, thinking through the project. He's sort of a very, very thoughtful person, very, very intellectual. And leading up to this point, he had his successes, he had his failures. So he was very, very calculated in when he was going to return both to opera, which he did with Semyon Kotko, I believe in 39, and then with the symphony at this point. So he starts writing it in July, but if you look at some of the materials, you can trace some of the ideas that he actually pulls forward and uses in the symphony back more than a decade. He kept sketchbooks, and so some of these ideas can be traced back about 11 or so years. But most of them come from sketches that he had, ideas, material he salvaged from other projects, failed projects, or projects that changed for one reason or another during the last 4 years. So about a month, he's modeling it off of Shostakovich's own Fifth in a lot of ways. It's got a lot of similarities. If you lay them side by side, the way that the movements unfold parallel each other in a number of interesting ways, where there's a martial theme, where there's sort of a folk element, where there might be a moment of lament, where big structural dissonances fall, even those kinds of things are there. But the time he's writing it, he's actually not in his home area. He's been evacuated to a resort town, Ivanova, about 150 miles east of Moscow. And he's there with a community of other composers. Shostakovich is there, his former tutor, Glier, Khachaturian, Shaporin, Kovalevsky, who's part of the party leadership for the Composers Union. These are all people that he's working with and interacting with. So it's a very fruitful environment that he was working at the time. But as far as the political pressures, I think Ben and I have both sort of touched on this. He has a very, very different opportunity at this point because of the war than what he had before. The 1932 to 1936, that sort of playing around, experimenting with this new socialist realism, music's a little bit different. Then we have, of course, muddle instead of music. That shifts things. But with the war effort, it's less about promoting ideology and more about uplifting the Russian people, entertaining, promoting the war, projecting a victory that they knew would be coming, this positivist approach to composition. In this space, this is what he's writing in. He has a lot less limitations placed on him. Not saying that he completely reverted to a 1920s approach, but he's very careful in when he does things certain ways, because he's trying to project an idea of progress and victory in the war. Even though the symphony, he says, is sort of, I can't remember his exact words, but the spirit of the people, the spirit of man, there's no actual program. It's a sort of unfolding of general ideas that leads to some triumph at the end, though it's very, very general. And that's where what he's working with at that time, is this freedom to compose and in a very, very rich and sort of fruitful environment where he gets lots of feedback and lots of support that he doesn't really have when he's not in a similar environment with others around him.
Yeah, there's a question in the chat. I don't know if either of you want to respond to that, about the piano part specifically playing an important role in the Fifth Symphony, and inquiring about your thoughts on the use of piano in the other symphonic work of Prokofiev.
Not the role of the piano itself, but I, when we were listening earlier, he prepares his piano score in about a month. Ben had mentioned that. a lot of his orchestral music is pianistic in my mind. It's almost like he's churning out ideas at the piano. And so I hear a lot of the piano like writing in his music in general, but I don't have any specific comments. I'm sorry about that. But the whole work in my mind has a lot of qualities of pianistic writing, particularly his own sort of motoristic kinds of these moments.
Yeah. Ben, you look like you wanted to add something there to all of this.
Yeah, it's amazing how the piano plays a role in this work. And it's sometimes behind the scenes, and sometimes it's just a color again that we talked about earlier that he brings in just for a very sporadic moment. I don't recall his other symphonies that have the role of the piano quite this much. I don't think the six that I recall and the earlier, the second, third, and fourth are not played very much. I haven't listened to them lately. I don't recall the piano playing a prominent role. I think it was an orchestral color here and rhythmic energy that he's bringing in this role. So yeah, the piano is very important to him in this symphony as well.
So Ben, Prokofiev's Symphony No. 5 was widely embraced by orchestras, and Koussevitzky proclaimed, and I'm quoting here, the Fifth Symphony is the greatest musical event in many, many years, the greatest since Brahms and Tchaikovsky. It is magnificent. It is yesterday. It is today. It is tomorrow. So what has become the legacy of the work, and how is it perceived today?
Well, if you look at record sales outside of the classical symphony, which is very short, very marketable, and very much fun, that is the piece that has, that's the symphony that has been recorded the most. But second is the fifth. And I think as far as, Thierry had alluded that the earlier symphonies after the first were not so successful, he was not really a successful symphonic composer, a la Shostakovich. The fifth certainly is. All the things you said about it are because of its melodic interest, the happiness with which he was writing this work. This short period of time during the war, he was in love, he had left his first wife, he was getting support. So I think that happiness boils over into this, and it's the most optimistic, fun work, even though it's got satiric things that Prokofiev could not get away from. That was the of Prokofiev, to be able to write these biting sarcasms at times. There are moments of that, but the lyricism, each of the first movement, the fourth movement opens with lyrical moments, even though they start getting faster and things. He was a master at this. And I think because of that, you still see people, and I've read a bunch of reviews of recent recordings and things, and they talk about the melodic content, the beautiful orchestration that he's doing. And because of those, the very reason that the Lexington Philharmonic is performing it is because of its melodious content all the way through. And it has some of the greatest of his melodies. And if you go listen to the Sixth Symphony, which is also considered a major symphony, it's not nearly as tuneful. It's not nearly as lovable as the Fifth. And if you listen to the Third, it's not the same type of symphony at all. So I think he found his niche. I've read at times that Prokofiev was not trying to be innovative in this work. He was just trying to write something to express his own personality, his own happiness at the time. And was not trying to be innovative necessarily, but to combine his harmony and his love for orchestration into this work in a way that was not trying to push it forward. And I think audiences today, as well as promoters like for orchestras, want this piece to be performed because it's very attractive to the public.
I turned off my camera for a second. I was listening to you, but so I could grab my Daniel's book off my shelf to just check in terms of instrumentation. So of course the classical symphony does not have piano in it, but the second symphony does have piano. Third symphony does not have piano. Fourth symphony does not have piano. Although there's a revised version that does have piano. So the first version did not, but the second version did. Of course, the fifth we know does. The sixth does have a piano part. Seventh does have a piano part. So there you go. But to your point of color, I think, of course, like you described, the piano provides this rhythmic kind of aspect that I think is very characteristic of all the things that we're talking about. And I think your discussion earlier about the intentional use of the orchestra and the colors in the orchestra, I think it's profound that he's using the piano, you know, in this very specific way throughout the landscape of his writing. So thank you both for all of your comments about all of that and the legacy of the work and everything too. So I'm pitching now or pivoting now to a question that is a little bit more focused on kind of the aftermath of the war in terms of how it has impacted classical music. And so there's a new book that recently came out titled The War on Music by the conductor John Macheri. And its premise is that after Europe's great composers fled to America during the war, Europe turned its back on them while America turned up its nose at classical music's European roots. Many of these displaced composers were forced to make their living composing for film, television, and Broadway, and Americans came to identify serialism in the avant-garde with being anti-Nazi and leaned into those sub-genres. The musical trajectory of the 20th century is one of slow separation between classical music and the public. Okay, so this is a brand new book with a really interesting premise and kind of provocative thought pattern behind it. And so it's really suggesting that all of our interactions with classical music today were directly impacted by these changes that occurred during and after the war. So I just would love to hear from you both about this. Do you think this is true? And, you know, how did World War II ultimately reshape classical music? And maybe just like specifically here in the US, you know, because yeah, it's totally different time now. I don't know who wants to go first. It's also a big question.
I can jump in if you want. Sure. Yeah, I teach 20th century music. So you could just, we just finished, I have the exam today. You could ask them after the 40s, when the changes happened in the 50s, the dissonant music that we're looking at from the 12-tone music to what Boulez and Stockhausen are doing, it becomes very much amelodic. It becomes atonal in a very systematic way, and it's not attractive music at all. And the audience did shift away to the point where Babbitt wrote his famous article, Who Cares If You Listen, that got published in 1958. So there was a huge divorce, and people in the ivory tower could write all of these serial pieces, which they did. And Boulez said, if you do not write in the dodecaphonic, which is the serial style, your music is useless. He capitalized U-S-E-L-E-S-S. Because that was what they were promoting, and it was anti-Nazi, because the fascists had you know, banned that type of music. That's why Schoenberg and others left, because they couldn't have the freedom to do that. So yeah, I think there's quite a bit of the truth to this premise that the music did shift, and particularly in America, but in Europe as well. Europe was even more of a driving force for anti-beauty. And as people said after the Holocaust, how can you write beautiful music? So there was that sense that we didn't really regain in America until after the Vietnam War. So in the 1970s, we had this return back to tonality, to neo-romanticism. So I think that should, I'd be interested in reading the book.
One thing that comes to mind for me as well is thinking about what music's imported at the end of the 19th century. A lot of it's the popular music. It's the British operettas. It's the pop music of the time. So I don't necessarily think that there maybe was a strong audience for that, for art music. It was very much a class specific product for consumption. We don't have a tradition of great librettists for opera. I think that's one of the reasons that we don't have a lot of operas coming out in the first part of the 20th century. We don't have we don't have our great symphony halls until the end of the 19th century. We have, as Ben said, we have these composers in the academy who are sort of establishing, this is the music you should compose, this dodecaphonic music. And you have these composers like Babbitt who are calling themselves composers for other composers, not for the general audience. But then there's also the strong, I'm from pseudo-rural West Virginia. In the mid-point of the 20th century, we have a local orchestra. All these little communities in Indiana that I'm living in and around now have local orchestras. And that's something that has survived despite the sort of highly dissonant music of the second half of the 20th century. So I'm not really sure how to answer that question. It's a huge question. It's a really interesting premise. I guess I'm going to have to buy the book.
Maybe we all should read it and gather again. It is an interesting question, but I think it is interesting this idea that, of course, a massive world event like World War II, you know, reshapes many things in our culture, and of course, it makes sense that music is of course reshaped as a result of that. So I do again want to encourage our audience to ask any questions. And I do want to take a moment to circle back to what we had discussed earlier about Ukraine and providing resources to our audience that may be interested in learning a little bit more about Ukrainian music and culture, which we did not discuss too much today. So Maria Sonovietsky is a scholar who has a wonderful discussion titled Understanding the War on Ukraine Through Its Musical Culture. And it's a YouTube video. I would encourage any of you that are interested to watch this discussion. It was excellent. It doesn't focus too much on classical music, but she provides a lot of really excellent examples that just relate to just understanding, you know, the culture through music. And then also there is a link to Ukrainian Live Classic, where you can research Ukrainian composers. And on that website, there are free scores and parts for performance if people are interested in performing these works. Maria passed along that link as well. So I would encourage people to check out that link too. There's a question in the audience. Can you speak about the genius of Prokofiev's lean orchestrations in his later works, please? The scores are reminiscent of Mozart, such color with no extra notes. I adore Prokofiev. Okay, so thank you, Laura, for your question. So how would you all would like to respond to that? Again, this orchestration question with Prokofiev.
So I have a few things coming to mind. So part of me wonders if these later works, its limitations on resources, financial, where he's concentrating his efforts are maybe smaller ballet, not ballet, but opera theaters that have maybe smaller orchestras. He's writing suites, but then he's also writing these huge works as well that I don't think people are probably all that well aware of. Ode to the End of the War is this massive work for, of course, it's got four piano, it's got a wind band, it's got eight harps, it has a full string bass section. That's sort of about the grandeur of surviving the war and the victory over fascism and the Nazis. But as far as these smaller orchestrations, these smaller works, I don't have anything specific really to add there. I know that he adored Mozart. That's one of the first things he learned was from his mother is Mozart. So Mozart sort of sticks in his mind. And he draws from that as an inspiration, the classical symphony, Haydn, another small work. And these are some of the more successful works of his youth. So maybe he's returning to that, looking for any way to be successful after struggling as a Soviet composer, and then sort of coming back from this 1948 maybe resolution, depending on what specific works Laura has coming to mind there.
Yeah, the only thing I can add, the leanest that he was when he was in that neoclassic period for his very first classical symphony, that is very much Haydn-esque. And I don't know that he ever wrote for an orchestra smaller than that and the way that he's putting it together. His Seventh Symphony utilizes things in a much more lyrical way, and is I'm not sure what you're thinking about with later works. That's his last symphony, which does not have nearly the aggressiveness and harshness. It's the most beautiful in some ways, almost easy listening to some degree, of all of his symphonies. So the Seventh is not very popular here, but it has some wonderful themes, but it's almost what was left of him that he was afraid to express. To me, it's always been a sad work when I listen to it, because that's not the Prokofiev that we knew and loved when he was in his prime. But his orchestration is very different there as well, and the colors he puts together.
And his output in general changes after the Fifth Symphony. He has a stroke, essentially, and collapses, falls down the stairs about a week after he conducts this symphony. And he never really recovered. He never conducted again. He never played piano again. His composition time was very carefully monitored by his second wife, Mira. She's like, okay, you're going to work and then pull back and rest, not to overdo it. He didn't get to attend some of the premieres of his works. So I think not just the war, not just being in Stalin's Soviet Russia, but his own health and the declines there. He had high blood pressure for years that he never treated, and it sort of hit him very hard suddenly, and he was never able to get back over on top of things again.
So I think we're getting towards the end of our hour. And so I just want to give you both an opportunity to add any final thoughts before we wrap up our discussion today. And I do see Laura put in an additional comment in the chat too. So yeah, number of players, not in terms of that, but more the kind of clean, simple lines, yeah, compared to the lush harmonizations. So yeah, I think that's a good observation there. I think Ben and Terry, you spoke to that a little bit about some of these things that may have influenced him at that point in his composition. Yeah, go ahead. Did you want to add something?
Yes, yeah. Right there, it's that emphasis on clear melody, accessibility mm-hmm. to the Soviet people. Those are the things I think that are at play there, is this idea of accessibility, simplicity, and just sort of thinking about not just the symphony-going elite, but the average Soviet listener.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
His ballets, and again, the Seventh Symphony show that lushness as well. And then parts of that lushness is in the Fifth Symphony. The third movement is one of the mm-hmm. luscious scores I think he wrote.
Which I believe is salvages material from Romeo and Juliet, which is probably one of the most beautiful lyrical ballets of the 20th century. Yeah.
Okay, so thank you both for being here. Any final thoughts that you want to share about Prokofiev, art music of World War II? I know we could keep talking forever about this, you know, these topics are all very, very big, but we certainly encourage everybody to click on some of the links and learn more about all of this. But any final thoughts you'd like to share before we wrap up?
I think anytime you go into Prokofiev, listening to a Prokofiev work, try to allow yourself to sort of get captured in the individual moment, because every individual moment plays a role in his music. Unlike Shostakovich, where he sort of plants a seed and you get to see it slowly grow, Prokofiev has a clear, specific goal at any given moment. And it's like I said, I tell my students, it's sort of like building with Legos. Ooh, I'm going to play with this idea and then I'm going to put something else on top of it or next to it. So going in, listen for that. And then if you pay attention to the character, you really get a sense of who Prokofiev was as a person. He's very playful, wicked sense of humor, sometimes unintentionally cruel. He'll play on one thing and alienate someone for years because he thought it was a joke and he wasn't expecting the reaction, but he has a very wicked sense of humor, and you can hear that if you listen carefully as well.
I just encourage people to go out and listen to it. If you don't think you like music of the 20th century in the spirit of time, it's just a grand work. It's one of the most attractive symphonies in the repertoire. And I think if you want something that's different, nothing sounds exactly like it. It's a pretty imaginative work. And I think it's the work I keep going back to of his symphonic music because of the variety that he has and just the magisterial way he handles it. He was at his prime. This was while he was writing so many other things. And I believe that it's a work that I teach it often because it's one of the pieces that students love because of the variety. And he never does things exactly the same way. So he's full of surprises. So just when you think you've lulled into this theme, he will bring in this little fast pattern that will totally change everything. So I love some of his counter themes, and it's just a joy to listen to. So I encourage everyone to go for it. It's fun work.
Yeah. Orchestra chatters a lot to one another.
Yeah. Now, I just also want to say that both of you have really interesting areas of interest, you know, music of war and, you know, Russian and Soviet music. So I would encourage our listeners and viewers, if they want to learn more about these topics, maybe they can send you an email or reach out or send us a question and, you know, we can pass it along to you. But just, you know, obviously these are huge topics and really interesting areas of expertise. So we want to thank you both for sharing all of that with us tonight. And we are so looking forward to LexPhil's performance of Prokofiev Symphony No. 5 Saturday, May 21st at the Singletary Center in Lexington. I encourage everyone watching to learn more again by visiting some of the links that we've shared. And you can also view any of our past Connect talks through our website. It's www.lexphil.org/connect-stories. I think Sarah can put it in the chat. But thank you again for being here, and we look forward to seeing everybody soon. And thank you for your support of LexPhil. Have a great night, everybody.
Thanks.
Good night.